All right. Hardly 5 minutes of break before the next match started, and what we got is a 125 race featuring Bob Jewett versus Shane Van Boning. I just sat down here. No balls have been made yet. Or maybe there are, no, maybe a ball had so far. Three. One or two balls have been made. Bob tried to cut the three. Missed it, hung it in the hole. And Shane's got the 14-3, which I believe he'll play softly. The strategy here would be to play the 14-3, leave the 14 hanging in the hole, use the 15 to break the balls, and should you not get a shot out of that stack once it scatters, the 14 would be a safety valve. Okay, actually, he couldn't see the 14-3. So he used a different ball to get to it. All right, and I apologize for that because I have a different perspective of the table. I'm looking at the screen and not the table directly. All right, I've never really watched Shane play one clock, a straight ball. I know he runs a lot of balls. He ran almost 200 balls in practice the other day. I want to see whether his style is pattern play or shot making or combination thereof. He's a great shot maker. But to run that many balls, you can't just rely on shot making. You have to be a pattern player. By pattern, I mean running balls and transition from one easy shot to the next gracefully without much work. Hit and stop kind of transition. See, you can tell from that shot that the pockets are very forgiving. They're standard 5-inch cut, Brunswick 5-inch pockets. You hit them pocket speed, they're going to fall. He opened up the balls and he knew that he's got the 6 and the 15 as safety valves. 10 in the side, maybe the 7 next. He almost took, he took his eye off of that and looked at the cue ball. Where is it going? Almost missed it, but on Brunswick tables, once you hit the inside of the pocket, it's almost automatic. Unless you pound
yeah.
it.
Yeah, speed kills.
Yeah. I absolutely cannot tell whether the 9 or the 7 or both are makeable here.
The one he shoots is going to go.
Yeah. That's something we will remember. If he gets down on the ball, don't second guess. It's makeable. He's got enough space to make it. He just pushed the 9 into break shot position, even though the 4 is a break shot. But he's got the opportunity to use the 4 as a key shot, meaning the shot before the break shot, and the 9 as the actual break shot. So now he goes to work. He's going to shoot the 1, and then shoot the 5, and then the 6, or 1, 6, 11, 5. It doesn't matter what he does with right. that last 4 balls. It's his choice, you know.
Yeah, I thought he was going to go for the 11, but he did go for the 5.
Yeah. The, you know, the last 4 or 5 balls, if you transition from one to the next easily, no one can judge what you did as long as you get there.
Shane's another one that shoots with an over-length cue.
Yes, 65 inches from what I understand.
65 now? Wow.
That's what I understand.
That's almost getting too long. I'm, you know.
That's secondhand information from Tyler. I've never asked Shane himself.
I'm sure he's probably accurate. I knew it was in there somewhere.
6-4 and a perfect break shot. All right, let's see how he shoots the 4. beautiful angle. Beautiful angle.
Now, many people may not know who Bob Jewett is. He writes articles for Billiards Digest and some of the others. He's been doing it for 25 years. He's one of the main contributors towards straight pool high run contest at Derby City. He's a recognized expert on physics and balls and how they do this and how and rules and everything. He's really a wealth of knowledge and a pretty good player. Very independent thinker. His stick, for instance, is his shaft is specially made out of ramen wood.
Really?
Because it's so light. Because he gets zero deflection, mm-hmm. but he doesn't have a low deflection shaft.
I see.
Yeah.
Ooh. Mm-hmm. What kind of wood do you send?
Ramen wood, which is that usually used, that's what the cheapest Chinese cues are made out of. You know, it's kind
really?
Of a yellowish, greenish wood.
And that contributes to low deflection because of the weight.
No weight.
It's light.
See, he's, and you know, you'll look at his ferrule, how short it is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what the butt is. He told me, I just don't remember. He and Dr. Dave do a lot of the...
Right. Well, they're both...
smart.
Yeah, I believe Bob is an ex-IBM engineer. Dave is a professor of mechanical engineering.
Actually, he worked for several different companies, kept changing names, but he designed chips and all that. He was way up there, and that's smart stuff. But he's been a pool freak forever. Lives
right.
In the Bay Area, San Francisco area.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you'll find, if you watch him, he'll play a relatively simplistic game. Just do what's necessary and no more. Because
right.
he's so analytical.
Right, I can tell. I recognize that I'm an electrical engineer by profession. Yeah, that's what I was supposedly in Syracuse for, but I hardly finished my master's degree. I was playing pool all the time.
Yeah.
It came down to going to class or going to the pool room.
Funny. Pools, it's like a disease.
Of course.
It comes back and haunts you about 20 years later, too.
Yeah, it does.
Because I quit for 15 years, didn't wasn't even around a pool hall.
Yeah. My plans were to go for a doctorate degree, and by the time I finished my master's, I said, take me out of here.
Wow, you were really going the distance you get.
Yeah. But I had a pretty good career. I built and sold two companies, information technology companies.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, good for you.
And I retired in 2009, but it's been the worst time ever. There's nothing like being active and at work all
yeah.
the time.
Yeah.
So I'm starting again.
I tried that retirement thing once. I didn't like it
a bit. It's awful. I don't recommend it to anyone. All right. The one is a decent break shot. I like the one, but we also need to clear those balls around it. And that is going to be a slight challenge. Let's start with the 3 here, maybe, or the 10. I like the 3. If I can take the 3
he's
out
a little
of the
short,
way.
And I'm not sure he can reach the 3.
Right, right. I see. He's going to have to
jack over.
Ball
he's
going to have to shoot the 10. And let's see what his next shot would be. Okay, that's why I was thinking, what is it going to be? He can now go from the 4 to the 5 and then the 3. He's going to hit that with low right to stop the cue ball. But he might have something else in mind, too. Oh, he's going to take the 1. He doesn't. He figured maybe the 13 is a break shot. I like the 1. I would try it and preserve the 1 as a break shot. It's in such a beautiful, nice, ideal position for me, personally. Okay. All right. Look what he did. He made the 8 much easier
mm-hmm.
to play. He can shoot the 4 now and then transition to the 15-4, 15-3-14. Because he's got the angle on the 4 in the side, and I would shoot that, get on the 15, 4, 3, clear those up, and then the 8, and then the 5 as a key shot. Okay, he's playing it differently. He's playing it differently. I'd like to see when he might want to make the 5 and nudge the 13 further away. But he looks like he's drawing it. All right. He did nudge it. Okay. He didn't nudge it. It's in a better position now. It's in a better position. Make the 3. The 4 is going to be the key shot, I believe. Yes. Okay. Well, he came up with something productive. 15-14-4. Alright, here I would like to shoot and come back out. He's got an angle on it, so I'm interested in seeing how he'll play the last two balls. Is he going to draw it and make it on the side? Draw it slightly. Yeah, like that. Oh, okay. Now he's got the perfect angle. He might throw it into the side and stay there or go up and down.
I think he's going to just draw it back.
Yeah, just draw it back. Throw it a little bit with English like that. Perfect. Yeah. Well, he plays good.
He does play good. I have no idea what his high run is, but he's always a threat to put run a rack or two, I'm quite certain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he played the pattern nicely. It was a different pattern than what I had in mind, but it got him there. And the reason he played the pattern different is because he wasn't satisfied with the initial position of the 13. He improved the position of the 13 ball to create a more effective break shot. He broke him very successfully. He's got an easy shot to start with, the 14 ball, from where he can transition to whatever he decides to do next. Maybe the 9. Maybe come down, play the 4-3-8. Just don't get yourself in trouble. I don't know about that. Why do all that? You didn't need to do it, but fine. You elected to do it. Let's see what's next. 12 on the side, because I don't see him.
Yeah, everything's on top of
the 2. He's looking to cut the 2. There are easier shots. You can shoot the 5 in the corner, and then automatically have the 15 and the 9. Oh, no, okay. They might not be available. I don't know. Let's see. Again, perspective. Yeah, he's shooting the 15 or the 9 here, and the 9 probably. The reason why I wouldn't shoot the 15 here is because I will have the opportunity to nudge it later on, make a break shot out of it. Tyler with us, who just finished that earlier match we were commentating on. He had a run of 47 some balls, I believe, 48 balls. Congrats on a good performance.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
We were talking about you being in your infancy as far as your pool career, and you have a lot of promising years ahead of you. So keep up the good work.
Always room for improvement, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. I'm 50 years old and I'm still working the hardest I can to improve. All right, well, Bob played the shot. He tried to break that little cluster which he unnecessarily created earlier.
Yeah, I think he wanted to run through that ball a little
bit. He didn't have to, you know. Now the only shot he's got available, reasonably makeable, is the 11. The 4 is, oh, okay, he might have the one in the side.
Yeah, I'll probably bump the 15 out for a break ball.
Yeah. He has the one in the side. From here on the screen, it looks like it's almost frozen. Apologies for that.
I'm surprised he drew that ball back.
Yeah, he should have nudged the 15. We were talking about it earlier that it should be left there for an opportunity to nudge it later on, make a break shot out of it.
Right, and then he could have played a 10-7 combo after. But getting on the 6 to break up the 10 was
good. Why not take
good.
The combo right now? You know, take the combo right
oh,
now.
Oh, the 8-3, that too.
Yeah, but he has the opportunity here to separate the 7-10 and then play the combo. Either way is fine. Now, he was trying to make a break shot out of the
right,
10.
Right, he's trying to push a 10 underneath the 4.
Yeah. And he's got a little problem. He needs to get rid of the 7 immediately so he can shoot the 10 down the corner.
I like getting an angle on the 7. Kind of underneath the 15, cut the 7 and try to bump into the 15. That way you have the 4 on the side as
okay.
your reserve ball.
All right, look what he did. Okay, I think the 15 is makeable.
Yeah.
15 is makeable. It didn't have to come out that nice.
That's the 11.
He could have. Yeah, you're right. 11, I'm sorry.
That's right.
The 11 is makeable. The 11 is makeable. He could have gotten in trouble.
Right. I like getting that 8 off the rail as soon as possible, too.
I don't like that. I like getting rid of that 15 quickly if it's makeable. The 11, I'm sorry. Oh, look at that.
What's he going to do for his
He's
going to
shoot. Yeah, I don't know.
He might leave the 10 for a break ball if he can get on the
rail.
Oh,
yeah, I know exactly what he's thinking. He's going to do the 7, 8, 4 in the side, and then the 11, his key shot, leave the 10 as his break shot.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Where's he going?
You see, had he gotten the 8, and he played for the 8, he could have made the 4 on the side. 15 in the corner, hit and stop, leave the 10 as a break shot. Wouldn't be the best break shot in the world. What he wants to do right now is leave the 8 as a break shot. That's what he wants. But look at that. He's almost aiming to miss it. What did I say? Oh, my God. I don't know what he had in mind there. Okay, I didn't like that pattern. I didn't see anything productive in that pattern he was playing.
Shane being a one-hole player, I like him going off the right side of the 10, off the rail, and just freezing on the 11.
You don't think he's just going to shoot it? Just
no.
Shoot in the corner?
No, I think he's going to
play safe.
Play safe.
All right, I'll make a little bet with you. We don't have to wager anything.
Really? He's going to cut that ball in the corner?
Of course. He's Shane, man.
Weesh.
It's not like he's cutting that ball in the corner for sure. And making it.
What do I know?
Oh, you know enough. All right. He's going to shoot. We know what he's going to do from here on. He needs to get good enough on the 11 to shoot it in whatever pocket he chooses and have an angle on the 8. The 8 is the break shot. He might come around the table. Or he looks like he's thinning it and coming down. Okay. He's shooting it down table. Okay. I thought he'd come around the table and shoot in the same pocket. But you know, all he has to do now, roll it in, come middle of the table.
Good shot.
And be ready to shoot a break shot. He might put a 100-some balls in out here. Who knows? But I definitely did not like what Bob had in mind for that last, for this rack.
Yeah,
Tom, it was all over the place.
Tom Karabatsis calls that scrambling. Sometimes you just can't get the cue ball under control. You got to scramble, scramble, and scramble until you can get it under control. Here, I think he wants to hit the probably the top of the two. Push the hit the top of the two, go off the four, and push the ten out.
You have to glance off the side of the stack here or
right.
You'll end up with nothing.
He'll draw this ball a little bit.
Right. Oh, that's
okay.
How he
perfect.
Nicely glanced off
yeah.
of that stack.
Good
gracefully.
Speed.
All right, is he going to break the stack with a three ball? It's available. The balls haven't broken.
I don't think you'll get much separation. You'll hit the bottom of the one. And then go into the 14. So it's.
He's going to use it at some time to do that. He can. What else can he do? I mean, that's what's available right now.
From up here, the one looks pretty close to being wired.
Let's see what balls he hit. He's going to shoot the three, break the ball. Let's see what ball he hits. He hit the one and missed again. That's a second break shot he misses.
That one ball looked wired. I liked him shooting the ball down the rail and shooting the 13 and getting up for that one ball.
Well, I like what he did, you know. He
right.
just had to focus a little more because he had the 14 next.
Well, he tried to hit that ball thicker so he can hit more of the stack. He
more of the one ball.
Right.
You're probably right.
He tried to throw it with
you're
outside English.
Right. That's the second. He almost broke his stick, but he snapped it on the table, which tells you it's okay to have a temper. You can always turn it into a positive energy. You don't have to keep it.
All right, let's see what Bob can do here. That was actually a pretty big shot right there. He might not have bumped that too, but that helps this rack out a lot.
Mm-hmm. Come around two rails.
I like coming around
the one.
Yeah, I like shooting the one and bumping the 12 out for your break ball. Oh, it went a little high.
He's playing the four on the side.
Yeah.
But I really would have liked to clear up the 1-6.
Right.
And then bump the 9 or
the
whatever.
The 9 and the 12. Because then you got those balls on the
right.
side, the 11 and the 3.
Once you bump the 9 and the 12, the 7 becomes makeable in the corner. And the 10, 11, 3 would not be a problem. Here
he's
still
scrambling. Yeah, he's still scrambling a little bit.
He's all over the place with the pattern.
But
Shoot the three here.
I played my first straight pool tournament at Red Shoe as a qualifier for this tournament.
I did hear that you ran 70-some balls in that qualifier, so
yeah.
Congratulations.
Well, I didn't really know, you know, the mindset for this game, so
mm-hmm.
I
want to be honest with you. The last time I played it, was in the late 80s.
Sure.
I played a couple of games here and there, but nothing. I mean, with people, didn't want to play. Just to warm up. I forgot about patterns until yesterday or the day before. And I started playing with a great player here, Bob Medengian, who won 4 or 5 games. I never got past 70 in a race to 100. And when I started, I couldn't even see any patterns.
Right.
I looked at it and I said, you know, I'm not seeing any patterns. And then a few hours later, and I, you know, things came back.
Right.
And I'm glad I came to this tournament. I played the one pocket because now it opened my eyes. I said, I got to start playing one on straight pool again. You know, I really do want to play it again. Oh, my God, Shane. It... straight pool will improve your one pocket pattern playing as well.
One pocket, 8 ball, 9 ball.
Right.
Yeah, every game.
So, even though I'm glad I came for the one pocket,
okay.
I did well, I'm glad I came to see the straight pool playing talent. There's tons of talent in there.
Right. And what both these guys need to start doing right now is I asked Stan Sheffett what to do. You know, I didn't know how to really play straight pool.
Mm-hmm.
And he said pocket balls first, worry about the cue ball second. You know, obviously you have to play shape. But don't play perfect shape for every ball.
No, he said that because any ball you miss, you give up the table and the guy can win the game on you.
Well, right. And it's a confidence thing. Once you start pocketing balls, then your cue ball naturally comes on a string.
And by the way, you did fall into a trance during that run that you had earlier.
Yeah.
And I predicted you were going to run out the game.
You cursed me.
I cursed you. What can I say? But as I told you earlier, you took your eye off the ball. I was going to say something else. Oh, I mean, I'm leaving here at 4 to catch my flight back to Fort Lauderdale.
Okay.
But at 4 o'clock, Danny Baruti will be playing his match. And I'm going to miss that match. It'll be something to watch. Pattern-wise, I was watching the guy play his match last night, and his pattern playing is jaw-dropping, to say the least. It was...
That's who Alex ran 125 an hour.
That's right. But it was Danny was on a nice run when he, you know, faltered,
right.
Made a positional play, had to take a long shot, tried to juice it up. He had a long shot. He tried to juice it up and missed it. But if you're around, I would definitely watch that match. Watch his pattern play.
Who's Baruti playing?
Beautiful. That's him, Danny Baruti.
Who is he playing?
I don't know who he would be playing. Don't know. All right, well, listen, Bob recovered nicely here. Gave himself an opportunity to continue on. He's ahead, too. And as...
Yeah, he got majority of the rack on that one.
As questionable as his...
He might have gotten all of them.
Some of his choices were in the previous rack. He did really well in this frame. I like this angle. I do like the angle. Because that cue ball is going to blast through the rack.
Here he's just gonna use follow and go straight through the rack. You don't want to glance off this. You're gonna hit the one ball pretty full. So well, that was a nine ball. Shane looks pretty ticked, so he might take off and run now.
Thank you. Shane's playing. He seems a little upset at something. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, they're both still scrambling right now. Bob got in a little bit of a groove there, but that break shot was pretty tough. Shane's going to scramble, just pocket balls until he starts falling in line, and then...
Right. Yeah. And that's what happens sometimes. You have a hard time seeing patterns, but if you stay with it and make a few balls,
right,
then suddenly you fall into a groove,
right,
and you start seeing everything.
Here he'll snap back for the 7 or for the 4. Just push it over. That was a good shot. I didn't know he had that much angle. Alright, so it looks like the 10 ball is going to be his break. Leave the 14 as his key ball, and then just got to run the balls out from there. What he wants to do is find triangles. So he wants to have a triangle from the 4 to his next ball to the next ball. So after he shoots the 4, he'll pick another ball to make a triangle. So he's going to shoot the 5 in the side here. Or he's going to play it up in the corner. So there his triangle was 4, 5, and I think 12 on the side. Or I just might shoot the 7. I'd get the 7 out of the way just because it's, in, you know, he's got to clear out his break ball. Shoot the 7, follow with high inside, and get on the 3 or the 12 or the 1. You just got to keep making triangles from your next ball. That'll keep you in the right mindset instead of trying to run high runs. You just run 3 at a time, and then soon enough you're at 100.
Left the 14 there intentionally because it's going to be his key shot.
Yeah, he'll probably use the 15 to get on the 14. Unless he should get just the 2 and the 15 out right now.
He's playing the 2.
Yeah.
I thought he'd play the 3. Okay. I think he was intent on shooting the 15.
Right.
Now he's back to shooting the 3.
Right. Still scrambling 12. A little bit.
Yeah, he is. 3, 12, 1, 15, 14.
I can tell the way his facial expression is. He didn't like how we hit that
of
ball.
Of course, yeah.
He wanted that cue ball to be another 3 or 4 inches off the rail.
He's upset because he's missed 2 break shots.
Yeah.
And 1 shot in the side, so of course he's upset. And he missed another.
Yeah.
Maybe he's hearing us. I hope he's not hearing us.
I'm not sure how strong his hearing aid is. I don't know if that gets him all the way up to 100% or not. But I don't think he heard us. So both players are still scrambling, and this is looking really good for Bob. But he's probably going to shoot. Depends how confident he is. He might shoot the 14 first just to get rolling. 12 ball's not the easiest ball to start out with. The 1 ball kind of leads you into no man's land. You're going underneath your break ball, and you don't want to go near that 10. So I'm assuming you'd shoot the 14, the 1, 12, 15. There's your break ball for the 10. I'm not really sure why he's eyeing up the 1. Unless he wants to go 3 rails with the inside and leave that 14 there, but that's a pretty tough ball to shoot when you're scrambling. But obviously he feels comfortable with it. Oh, that was a nice shot. He got pretty deep in that corner there. Now his last 3 balls are just going to be the 12, 14, 10. So that's his little triangle he's got right now. He's got 15, 12, 14, and then once the 15's gone, he just goes 12, 14, 10. So you just try to pick out 3 balls at a time throughout the rack. really helps you simplify a complicated game, keeps it easy. So he's pretty much got the same angle as he did in his last break ball that he missed. So. Last time he hit it thick. Let's see if he adjusts and thins his ball up a little bit. Looks like he'll be going straight into the 11, so he just wanted his top spin with medium to hard speed run through the rack. Might even glance off the bottom of the 11 and go to the bottom rail. Never want Whitey that high, but got lucky with the 15. But that's what starts high runs. You got to get lucky. Get fortunate in a couple balls. You know, guys like Thorsten, they can pretty much tell you what ball they're going to shoot next after they go into the stack. They've hit so many break shots. I'm sure Bob's hit his fair share, but... doesn't have much angle. Yeah, I agree. He shouldn't have shot that one ball.
I would have left that one alone.
See, here you can shoot the 6, get on the 4, and shoot the 7, and go and split the 2 and the 6, or the 2 and the 13, and then leave your 5 as your next ball, your saver ball.
He's going to have to break those balls, and he definitely needs to leave one ball below the stack.
Yeah, you can shoot the 12 in the side, but it's hard to put some speed on that ball with confidence. I mean, you could even draw back to the first diamond right by that chalk, right below that chalk, and shoot the 12 in the side and leave the 5 as your saver ball. He's got the 8 in the corner, too. He might like that ball.
He's got the 8 in the corner to break the balls, you're right.
And once he, if he moves the 5.
He needs to be perfect on him. I predict that if he's not perfect on it, to loosen up those balls.
He went a little high.
Yeah, he's
not happy with that.
Now so he's going to have to shoot the 8, 5, and try to break him with the 12.
Right. And he might. What do you think he's going to do, shoot the 12 on the side or shoot the 12 in the corner?
I like it in the corner. But
spin this ball two rails.
He has to cinch this ball. Well, he needs to get rid of the 5 first.
Short. Now I'd probably shoot the 12 on the side.
If it's available on the side, I would definitely shoot on the side right now. But you think the 14 is in the way? You might want to take a look at the table directly to tell. Because we can't tell from here.
It looks pretty good from up here. I got a pretty good view.
Then you should have done it. Okay, now he's got the 12. He's got no other option right now. He's going to have to shoot the 12. Loosen up the balls.
What I don't like about this,
and pray for a next shot. He's going to run into the 14. The 14 is going to push the 15.
I think he's going to get a shot on the 3 next. The 13 will bump the 3 out just like that. A little too hard. When you only got a 4 or 5 ball cluster, you don't have to hit the balls that hard like that. Because that's what happens right there.
It was a little far away. He put a authoritative stroke on it and he hit it firmly. I would definitely shoot the 13 if it's available. Oh, excuse me. Yeah, it stayed there as a break shot. just get rid of the Hughes and Bridge shoot the three here. Unless you're going to be jacked up over the 11. He might, I don't know if he's going to play the 11, play the 14. He might not like the 11. It's too low. You know, it's too low. He might save the 14 as a break shot. No. He's going to, okay. Is he going to leave the three? He's going to cut the three in the corner and break the stack from below. Yeah, that's what he's going to do. A little unorthodox, but hey, that he's doing what the table is allowing him to.
He wants to get about a foot to the left of the spot here.
All right. That's good.
That's all good.
That's good. Now you focus on making the ball.
And here you want to use a lot of outside, and you don't want to hit the ball the corner closest to the 13. You want to swipe across it because you'll get stuck underneath. So let's see what balls are on the corner. You want to come across the 1 and the 10.
Right.
Because it'll have left spin when it gets to the rail and go out to the middle of the table.
Right.
I don't know if they agreed to rack their own or what, but they're supposed to be racking for each other. See how he came across them like
hit
that?
Hit it. Nice. All right. Break him again with the 10. Or wait for a better opportunity.
Yeah, the 10's hard because you got to use a little snip draw stroke. You won't get much separation. I think he just used a 4 and go into him. He's going to get high on the 4 right now.
See, this angle, the perspective here is so much better than the early ones.
Right. He didn't really get.
He didn't get there.
I don't think. You can shoot the 14 and draw into the, what is that? I can't tell. The 11 and the strike.
Shoot the 14 and use, later on, use the 12 or the 4 as a break shot. But he needs to do it quickly. He needs to open up them balls as soon as possible. He had the opportunity to take that 14 away. Oh, I see what he did. He's going to use the 4. He has the problem with that. If he doesn't get a shot after that, he doesn't have a safety valve to shoot something hanging. Okay, he did well. He did well. There weren't too many balls to separate, so they opened up nicely. He does play all right.
Yeah, the tough ball on this rack's at 13. He's got to get that 13 in the side as soon as he can. That opens up the 12 and the 11. The 11's probably going to be his break ball. Unless he wants to use the bottom ball break with the 7. I actually like that.
He needs to deal with those three balls immediately, 11, 12, 13.
Right.
You know.
I like the bottom ball break here. If that 7 ball's in a good position. Yeah. The 15 gets to the 7 pretty good. You can use the 1 to get to the 7.
I agree.
Is he going to shoot the 15 now with inside?
Why not shoot the 1 and with follow into the rail and out? Try to nudge the 11, 12, 13 on that cluster. He's got the angle for that, and it's a safe shot.
It looks like he'd go a little long and clip to 7.
Yeah, maybe. He's shooting it with inside English.
Yeah. Yeah, see how it clips to 7 like that?
All right. He made a break shot out of the 7. It's a little low, but depending on the angle, he'll be all right. Yeah. Why not shoot the 15 right now?
I like shooting the 5 and stopping for the 8. You know, I can cut the 8 and
how
go into
the 12.
How about
shooting the 15 and loosen up those three balls?
Go off the 7 into the, what is that, the 12? Oh, wow, he came underneath it.
So he still has an issue here. If he wants, I mean, it's an unresolved situation.
I think he's going to use a little snip draw and draw to the rail and then shoot the 12 in the corner next. So he's going to shoot the 13 in the side, kind of snip it back.
Mm-hmm.
You'll watch, he's not going to follow through all the way on this ball. He's actually going to, not decelerate, he'll accelerate to the cue ball, but it's like a little punch.
Right, right. He's throwing the ball, hitting it thick with low left and throwing the 13.
Right, he's going to catch this little thick. See how he didn't go through that ball very much? Now, how do you like shooting the 5 and then shooting the 11 in the corner, or in the side, I mean?
Right.
8, well, 7 is your key ball.
11 is the break shot. 7 is the key ball.
Yeah, he can shoot the 12. 11,
I'm sorry. 11, you're right. So 5, 11, 8, 7.
I think he's going to follow down to the rail with the right spin and go one rail and up. Just like that.
11.
Once
eight,
they get the
seven.
Speed down, you know, when they get up to the 80s and 90s, they'll be able to get that cue ball closer to the 11. Because the shot's not easy when the cue ball is like
it.
That. Yeah, just like that.
He missed it.
It's not an easy ball.
He had to roll that cinch it in the pocket.
Right. And subconsciously, he knew, you know, I made it way tougher than it should have been.
Sure.
You know. So here Shane's going to shoot the 8, go up for the 11. Then the 7 ball is going to be his key ball. Good shot.
Decent. Beautiful break shot. Can't believe Shane is behind by 38 points. Now I think we're going to see a different Shane, one that's going to bear down and say enough's enough. Two obstructs the view to the one, maybe? I cannot tell. I'm sorry. He's going to have to shoot the 14 because even the 3 is not available to him. So we're going to see a Shane Van Boning long straight-in shot. He's going to cinch it. Here we go. Hit it at an interesting speed, too. I mean, it's much harder to do what he did than to hit it with a hit and stop attitude, you know, put a stroke on it. Just didn't want to see the ball pop out. And as I said, we're seeing a different chain now, one that's about to go to work, maybe around 70 balls. Look at that cue ball. Did you see that? That was funny. That was like a trick shot. How do you? He's basically saying, how much you want to bet I'll go around that 3 without touching it? I'll carry him off the bottom of the stack, go around the 3, not touch it, be perfect on it. 11, I like 11 as a break shot, so I start to go to work with that in mind. He is playing the 5-13. That would make things a little easier. Whenever you have a combination and you take it, it opens up the stack and the rest becomes almost automatic. No problem. All right, what has he got here? 15 straight in. The break shot that I called earlier is no longer available. I think the 6 is a little too low, personally, depending on the angle. I for my taste, it's a little too low. It's workable, but it's a little too low. Anyway, I'd like to see how we negotiate the rest of the balls. Still has a little work with those 4, 8, 7. Two ball, you think he's going to use the 2 ball as a break ball? Yeah, possible. He's got a combination. Another one. Okay. Looks like he's going to shoot the 2. He needs to get rid of that 9 sitting there unnecessarily. And either the 8 or the 11 is going to be his key shot should he decide the 6 is his break shot. So why not shoot the 9 right now, then the 2? Or the 9-7. That is how I play. I would personally play 9-7. 2. 11-8. Oh, you see what he did? He wasn't satisfied with the 6 as a break shot. He tried to manufacture a new one. He tried to create a new break shot. You know, when you get the slate, you know, when you go work through the rack and at this slate stage, you can't be worried about making a break shot or manufacturing a break shot. You gotta take what the table is about to give you. The 11 could be a break shot here. The 6 is a subpar break shot. Nevertheless, it's a break shot. Play the 7, 9, 6, 8. Or 7, 9, 8, 11, depending on which ball you want to leave as your break shot. I think you'd end up shooting the 6 and leaving the 11 as a break shot. Either the 6 or the 7. I prefer to get rid of the 7, 9 as soon as possible. He doesn't have to jack up to shoot the 7, does he? No, he doesn't. It's just 7-9. Yeah. 7-9, 6-8. Comes in. 9-6-8. Okay, now he's back to thinking of the 6 as being a better alternative than the 11 as a break shot. So, 11-8. He has to draw into the rail and out. He doesn't want a big angle at all on that 6 ball. I think the six is a little too low. All right. Why didn't he accept the six in the first place?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
You know? He went back and forth in his thinking, and I could tell.
Yeah.
You know? He debated whether to keep the 11 or the 6 as a break shot a couple of times and changed his mind. Yeah, that's perfect. That's good. Still, I would have gotten a little straighter so I can draw off the side of the rack. But here, he's not going to be stuck because he's hitting the end point in the corner ball.
See, here on every break shot, I like to try and play straight for a ball just so you learn something every time.
Right.
You know, you get to learn where the balls are going.
When you hit them so hard, right, too, there's so many collisions, it's right. Almost hard.
He hit those a little firmer than I thought he would. Those broke up pretty nice.
If you hit in a cluster of 3, 4, 5 balls, that's a different story.
I'm going to put that one in the bank. That's not that bad of a break ball, to be honest.
Yeah, it was a good break shot.
Right.
It was a little low, but he produced good results with it. And the pattern could have been slightly different.
Here, I think I get a little angle on the 8 and just go split the 11 and the 10 after he shoots the 5.
I agree. Don't touch the 8-13. They are your insurance.
Where's he going? I like keeping the 7 there for his permanent break ball.
Yeah.
Unless he likes the 12 low like that again.
Yeah, maybe he does. Okay. He's got the 12, he's got the 10, he's got the 8. You know?
Yesterday, Shane was trying to get a little information from Thorsten.
About
break shots.
Oh,
Shane
yeah.
was shooting a break ball, and Thorsten walked by, and Shane ran over and grabbed him and said, "What would you do on this one?"
And did Thorsten volunteer that information?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
I'm glad to hear that because we want pool players to be cooperative and helpful. And in the old days, you know, that wasn't at all the case.
Oh, they wouldn't tell you anything.
It can only help the cause of pool. All right, now, you know, mystery solved. Just decide what you want to do. Get rid of either the 4 or the 13. Get rid of that 4. Leave the 13 hanging in the hole. Break shot. Decide early on which one you want. Get rid of the 2, the 9.
Actually, to be honest, the 9's a really good key ball, and that ball gets overlooked a lot. You can use the 11 and the 9 as your last two balls.
Mm-hmm.
Shoot the 11 in the corner, 9 in the corner, and the 9's a really easy ball to get above the 12.
Mm-hmm.
So, mm-hmm. And the 13's a real good ball to get to the 11.
I see.
But there's a million ways to run these out.
Look at this now. Now, don't tell me this is good position. He can't see anything. Now, he's going to make a ball, but, I mean, you know, make the combination now, 10-13.
Yeah.
But he was shooting without having resolved
right.
the problem.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? He hasn't figured out the pattern yet.
Right.
He's just shooting one ball at a time. And he missed the combination.
Oh, man.
He missed it. That's amazing. Concerned about that.
Yeah, and I'm buddies with Shane, so I want him to win, but I'm glad that he's making the same mistakes I did because I feel a little better. Straight pool's a hard game. It's so easy that it's hard.
Well, yeah, you have to break it down into simpler problems. Right. 3, 4, 5 balls at a time.
Right. That's why I like the triangle method. Mm-hmm. You know, pick 3 balls. Once you shoot, like, say he shoots a 10 here, pick another ball. You know, so 10, 13, 4, 8, 2, you know, whatever he wants to do. I wouldn't leave the 2 as a cue ball, just for an example. Where's he going? Where's he going?
It's amazing. What is wrong with you guys? Come on.
All right, so here,
the
simplest way for me is shoot a stop shot, leave an angle on the 4 to get to the 2, and get straight on the 8 on the side. Doesn't matter if he wants
He's going to go from the 13 to the ball against the rail on the other side, whatever that ball is, 2.
See, Dallas West would say less cue ball. You know,
yes.
Shoot a stop shot, shoot the 4, slide over for the 2.
Yes, that's how I always stop the game. Hit and stop, hit and stop. Hardly ever hit a rail if you have to.
Right.
So,
no, there's no gimme here.
No.
I mean,
it's all tough, right?
I like drawing for shape on the 8 because you'll be going with the line of the shot if you hit it with follow.
To shoot the 2 with follow and get rid of that 4. It's a funny location. You know what I'm saying? Get rid of the 4. Now, okay, he can get rid of the 4, but the 12 is—he needs to draw the ball.
Yeah, both players are still scrambling.
Either draw the ball or hit and stop and shoot the 12 in the opposite corner.
Right.
Oh my God! He wants the 12 as his break shot. Okay.
Yeah, he's gonna snap over. Always gonna follow this ball. This is a hard shot.
Two rail.
So you gotta hit it soft with spin like that. That was a medium speed. I like hitting it just with center ball and draw it one rail.
He's done well with it.
Yeah, he did pretty good.
All right, that's almost the same break shot Shane had earlier. Not exact, but almost.
Yeah, Shane's a little further from the rail.
And his cue ball was a little closer, so.
And Bob knows enough about straight pull. You would never draw this ball. You'd go straight to the corner.
Right.
You have to hit this ball with top. And hitting any ball with speed and topspin, you know, that's where people miss balls. So here, just a medium stroke. Make sure you get through the cue ball. Don't hit at the cue ball. Get through it. I know that's a mistake I made in my match 2 or 3 times. Let's watch this Q-tip and see if it gets through the cue ball. There you go.
Nice firm stroke.
Yeah. Why isn't he shooting the 11 and drawing into the stick?
You're right.
I mean, the 6 is a hanger, so you can just, you know, it's easy to get close to the 3 here, because I think that 6 is frozen on the rail. So I'm not exactly sure what he's doing here. See, that was kind of a super scramble shot, you know, just pray to
get. I don't know what he achieved with it, but
no.
He's in a position here to loosen up the balls off the 11. But the way he shot the other ball, it's not like he was playing pinpoint position. It just came out that way, you know. Go through the balls, you got the 3. Nothing happened to the balls except the 5 came out.
Right. And here, the 3 isn't really the best ball to go into those. I mean, when you go into the balls, you want the 10, because the 10 is closer to the rail or even frozen. With the ball being so far away from the rail, it's hard to
control. If he's going to break the balls here, I would go to the 7, the 1.
Yeah, the 1 you'll get stuck on the 8.
And he's going to use the 5 as a break shot or the 4, and he overhit it.
I think the 14 goes past the 3.
Yes, the 14, I'm sorry, is what I meant.
So here, I like to bring five the 15's going to hit the 7, into the 1, into the 8. He's going to push the 8 towards the corner and draw off the 15. So here, I would be trying to play shape for the 8. you know, just so you can, it might not happen, but you're going to learn something from it. You know what I mean? Instead of just blasting into them, you can play shape for a ball. And that way, you know, you play this game for 3 or 4 years and you'll get really good at knowing where those balls are going to stop. So I like a medium draw stroke here and play shape on the 8. 15 is going to go towards the bottom rail. Feel like that, he hit it too hard. You know, he wasn't playing shape for any specific ball there, you know? And it's easy to say when you're up here, but that's what I try to do when I'm...
Right. Yes, it gives matches. You something to look forward to. Right. Relieves the pressure.
Right.
Makes you focus more.
Right.
So, yeah, it's not just bang balls, just, right. You know.
And he couldn't hit that ball to foul because it would have gotten close to a scratch. He had to draw that ball.
I don't know if he's got anything dead here he's looking at. I don't think so.
Yeah. With how frustrated Shane is right now, and you never know, you never want to fire Shane up, but how about taking an intentional scratch and just pushing the cue ball up towards that rail, unless he's got a dead ball in there somewhere.
Oh, the 2.
Wow.
That's what he was looking at.
What do we know?
I didn't even see it. I was looking for dead balls, didn't see that angle.
He played a carom there, right?
Oh, he played a carom. Yeah, it was a carom?
Yeah, he played a carom. He played
wow,
a 2 off
another
ball.
Wow, that's even better. I'd like to see it again on video.
Now, that's going to fire him up. That might cost Shane the match right there. You know, because that pulling off a shot like that, you know, you're taking control of the match. That's showing Shane that you're not scared. You know, he's just going to fire at him. Balls out of the rack. 13 is probably his key ball. So now see. See how he's hitting the ball there with a little more confidence. He's getting through the ball, knows where the cue ball is going.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's not scrambling anymore.
So, come on, 5, 8, 7, 13, 15.
To be honest, I like getting really good on the 5 and the 8. So, how about the 15 in the side and then shoot the 8, 5,
all
7,
right.
13?
That too. If you play the 5 softly, you're going to play billiard on the 8, making the opposite corner.
You don't like to bump into balls late in the rack. I see their shot, but he'd probably draw it 2 rails if you do that. So I like getting real good on the 8 here. Trying to play pinpoint at this point.
Sounds good, but come on, what is that?
Holy smokes.
You're back to where you were.
Yeah, he's right back where he was before.
Exactly.
So now we'll see. Is he going to billiard it, or is he going to, I think he's going to draw it.
I would personally billiard it. Yeah, it looks really good. And now he's got one of the key shots.
It looks like you're going to hit high in the 8, push the 8 towards the middle diamond.
You hit it softly like that. There we go.
He controlled that really well. Mm-hmm. That could have gotten funny on him.
Now, get on the 7. Yeah, get on the 7 and the 13 straight in the corner where your break shot is going to go.
He's keeping low on the ball, too. So.
Oh, I see. Well, you know what? Either way is fine.
Sure.
Either way is fine. That's easier because less moving than the cue ball.
Right. He's going to want to get reasonably close to the 9. You know, you don't want the cue ball too high after he shoots the 7. Uh-oh.
He's all right.
He's going to have to go 1 rail, I think, with a little outside.
He's going to have to go into rail now. You're right.
He might hit this firm and go 3 rails the way he's been playing.
He does that. I'm going to bet on the other guy.
So how many balls did he get this rack? Shane made that long ball and made two or three more and then missed that ball on the side.
Didn't Bob break this rack?
Oh, yeah, that was a previous rack. I'm sorry.
Yeah, he's run over 20 balls so far.
Yeah, he's 20. Yeah.
20, exactly. Okay.
Yeah. All right. So he's going to draw into the top of the eight. Now, here you have to be careful. If you put too much draw, since you're hitting the top of the eight, that cue ball is going to take off to the bottom rail.
Right.
So this shot you hit with half a tip below center. You know, not a stop shot, but just have a little bit of
right, you need to separate. You need to get away from the rack.
Right.
I wonder how good it's going to break.
Right. This is a scratch in the corner, too, if he zips it a little bit too
much.
Right,
that's right. All right, you got that six. It didn't break particularly well, but guess what? Not a particularly good break, but he got a ball to work with now.
From watching Thorsten, I like shooting that ball at warp speed. You know you're going to make the ball.
Which one, the six?
No, that break ball.
Oh, okay.
Thorsten hits that ball at, break speed.
He's looking at the 15 next as another break opportunity. Who would have thought that?
Here, I like playing the six with top and going two rails down towards the three. It doesn't have too much.
I like to get on the 15 as soon as possible.
He's looking to see if the 15 is makeable.
It is. It looks, at least from here, it looks like it's makeable.
I don't think you'll be able to make it from the middle of the table. He'll have to be more towards the 6.
Mm-hmm.
See how he's off to the side there? He's not towards the middle.
Yeah. He needs to cut into the stack. He doesn't have to hit it particularly hard here. Nice, firm stroke.
So he's going to go off the 14 into the 12 here.
Right. The 14 is going to open up everything. 1-5 and 4-10. Here we go. And once again, a ball emerges as the savior.
Yeah, that.
There's a combination to the 5-8.
That happens when you get deep into your run. It seems like when you're trying to get going, that never happens. You always get stuck with that. With nothing. You like shooting the 8 right now. Now, those six balls right there, 12, 5, 11, 4, 2, they don't really go anywhere. The 12 and the 5 do, but you got to get.
I think the 4 goes. If he shoots the 1, the 4 does go in the corner.
After the 3 is gone?
After the 1 is gone, the 4 goes in the opposite corner. If he shoots the 1 right here, the 4 would go here, right?
Oh, yeah. Sure.
If he shoots the 1 in the lower right.
Yeah, shoot the 1 and go to 11 here.
Right. Because you want to get rid of the 3.
Uh-oh. Do you like doing shooting that ball up in the corner or being jacked up?
I definitely like to shoot the 10 here. It's such an easy shot. Even though you avoid most of the time shooting towards the opposite end of the table, this shot is a lot more comfortable shooting than jacking up and shooting the 12.
Sure.
Plus you remain nearby the balls. Hit and stop on the 4, hit and stop on the 12. Here we go. 4-2.
just looked at my bracket, and I play Kiyomko next at 4 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be Eastern time, our time. Seems like he kind of went back into scramble mode after he got going a little bit.
Taking a ball at a time, it seems to me.
Here you gotta make sure, you gotta hit this at a really good speed, because too hard to go up towards the side and too soft, it's hard to make the ball. Just like that, that's good speed. It's a break ball. What is he gonna use? 13 inside. Unless he likes the 8 in the corner and going one rail, but or not the 8, the 12 in the corner, but he won't have much speed at all.
Mm-hmm.
Unless he can use a 7 and clip the corner ball for his break. Ah, he's trying. Yeah, that was a good shot. Good shot. Real good shot. 13 in the corner, play 12 ball, 2 rails under the 7. Alright, let's see how Shane reacts now. He's going to shoot the 12, 13, 7. Depending, if that 13 is real deep, he won't use that ball as his last ball. That's what he's going to go look at now. See how deep that 13 is. If it's sticking out enough, he'll use it as a break ball. If it's not, he'll shoot it right away. Sure if you wanted to catch that ball a little bit thinner or you wanted to be that thick. Our other comment there is falling asleep on us here.
That's because I stay late every night. I was wide awake earlier. Same thing happened to me yesterday. So much mileage, man.
Hey, you're getting paid good money to commentate here. What are you doing?
Hey, I'm having the time of my life. I'm getting to watch some. You know, I'll be honest with you, and I hope people don't take it the wrong way, but pool is so hypnotizing to me that whenever I want to fall asleep, I put on a match on TV.
One pocket.
Any game, because the commentators are, you know, they have that low tone of voice, and they're like, okay, we're counting from 10 backwards to 1, 10, 9, he's shooting the break shot, 8, 7, he's got a shot on the next ball, you know, and suddenly you fall in a deep trance and you're all, you know, in a deep trance. I do fall asleep watching pool. But here, actually, I was extremely excited yesterday. I watched that match with commentated on every one pocket match, maybe the last 4 or so, and it was very thrilling to me. And even one straight pool here, calling the patterns, sitting up here and predicting what the player might do or what you will do. That's also practice. You're right. Practicing your pattern without having to shoot. It's pretty constructive.
I can't even tell you how many hours of YouTube matches I've watched.
Good for you. I think you have a bright future as a player. I really do. You have a good mind, too. Just stay away from the bad influence. That's the important thing.
Oh, yeah.
And you'll be all right. You got all the tools that you need. I see other youngsters hanging around, you know, like like a more accomplished player, and they try to emulate that player. And sometimes they inherit the same bad habits. You got everything going for you. You don't need anyone.
Thanks.
Just keep doing what you're doing. And I understand you're also at 21 years of age. You're also a CTE instructor.
I am.
CTE being the center to edge aiming method that Stan Shuffett developed.
Yes. Stan's the man, Mr. Miyagi of pool.
All right. He
really is.
I'll take your word for it. At some time, I want to get exposure to it and see. I have an open mind. I'm wanting to experiment with everything.
Yeah, for sure. I'll give a shout out to Stan if he's watching. Thanks, Stan, for teaching me pretty much not everything you know, but as much as you can. Probably missed a couple things, but
well, he kept a couple things for himself.
Yeah. And I'd like to give
like a true master.
I'd like to give Jerry Bryseth a shout out too from Madison or Arizona, depending on what season it is, because I wouldn't be here without Jerry.
He, you know,
really
Jerry
got my career started.
Yeah, I worked with Jerry myself in the late 90s.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's great.
Yes, he is. Jerry's one of those guys that can he can tell you're doing something wrong and kind of yell at you, but he gets the point across in a way where you're not, you know, timid to still learn. He's Jerry's something else.
He got me to stroke with my forearm and not the whole arm and the shoulder and
right.
All that.
Right.
Got that stroke right. Under control. You know, I went back and forth, and, you know, eventually I figured out it was the only method to stroke a ball cleanly. Because, you know, sometimes you watch other great players. They don't have the textbook mechanics.
Right.
But they've accomplished what they did with what they got, an unorthodox style, and it works for them because they're masters at it. Doesn't mean that you can emulate the flaws, quote unquote, that they have managed to turn into assets.
Right. Sale Shane hit the ball with right spin, so after he went off the rack, he'd spin towards the middle of the table. Mm-hmm. Now he caught that ball a little full.
So I said earlier, I'm interested in sitting down and watching how Shane plays patterns.
Right.
Because he ran almost 200 balls the other day in practice. But, you know, he's got such a tremendous shot-making ability that, you know.
He shoots his way out of every hole. I mean, he ran 305 balls at Steinway.
I have not seen any pattern that I want to emulate.
No.
So far.
No.
Meanwhile, when I watched Danny Baroudi yesterday, whatever little, you know, he ran a few balls on before he eventually missed. And then Alex took over and ran out of the game. But the way he ran the balls, Danny Baroudi, is jaw-dropping. His patterns are just absolutely beautiful.
Right.
The old-school way of running balls, the old-school way. Minimal movement in the cue ball, transition from one ball to the next gracefully.
Sure.
You know, it's just a pleasure to watch.
I want to say this real quick. He wants to get the 6 below the 10. Oh, he even hit the 6. He got that way too thick.
As I said, he's trying to make things happen that aren't there or...
Right. Well, if he would have, you know, the tangent line was to go under the 14 and bump the 6,
right.
And you don't want the 6 to be underneath your break ball. I was going to say, you want that 6 ball to move about a foot or two so you can still get to it. But Shane's kind of lost right now.
So is Stan still instructing himself, or?
Yes, Stan is retired now, and he's given lessons full time. Right now, he's actually finishing up his book, so he's putting lessons on hold. So I've gotten a bunch of phone calls since Stan said he's taking a break for not sure how long, probably a month, 2 months, 3 months,
mm-hmm.
as long as it takes.
Give a shout out to Tyler here, who's a CTE instructor. Anyone interested in learning the CTE method of aiming can contact Tyler. How do we contact you?
Facebook's good.
And what is your address? Tyler, last name?
Steyer, S-T-Y-E-R.
S-T-Y-E-R.
Yes.
Tyler, S-T-Y-E-R is Steyer. The last name, Steyer.
So if you're in the northern Midwest area, Stevie Moore is out on the East Coast over here giving lessons.
What's your email address in case they want to contact you that way?
TJS, Tyler James Steyer, so TJSCTE@gmail.com.
Here we go.
Wow, what an unfortunate scratch in the side.
TJSCTE@gmail.com.
If the first step, if you're interested in centered edge aiming, is go on Stan's website at justcueit.com, or if you Google Stan Shuffit, his site will pop up.
Let me ask you a question, Tyler.
Sure.
I would think that the player desiring to learn this aiming system should already be somewhat of an accomplished player, right? Not a beginner player.
A better player is most likely going to learn it quicker because he knows more about the game.
Right.
But
if a guy is still struggling with his mechanics, with his stroke and all that.
You need a reasonably straight stroke.
Right.
The system does straighten out your stroke by itself because you use a lot of center ball.
Mm-hmm.
So it keeps you from using a lot of backhand English. And, you know, it's centered edge is very friendly with spin.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously center ball is desirable.
Okay, it's friendly with spin, but how about if you use standard shaft or low deflection shaft or non-deflection shaft? How does that affect the system?
That would go over in the lesson. I use a standard maple shaft. Landon Shuffit uses a hybrid shaft. Stan uses a hybrid. Brandon Shuff, who just announced that he uses a system, he's been working on it for about a year and a half. He uses a maple shaft.
Mm-hmm. Brandon is my road partner, just to let you know.
Brandon's he's a great guy. I went out to dinner with him the other night.
And he did tell me last year he was in my house for a month or two, early 2015, that he had been using it.
Sure.
He couldn't explain it to me, but he was using it.
Right, and what's taken Stan the amount of time to write the book as he did is you have two intelligences. You have a visual intelligence, and then you have a language intelligence. Stan had the system where he could understand it himself, and that's how he put it into the DVD. He made his DVD in 2011. But he's writing the book right now, and his language intelligence is catching up with his visual intelligence, and he's able to explain it a lot better, 100% now. That's why he's writing the book. He couldn't explain it 100%, so that's why he started the book so late.
So is the DVD enough for someone to grasp the method?
Absolutely.
Really?
I learned the lesson, or not the lesson, the system pretty much by myself with the YouTube videos and the DVD. And then I went to Stan's house, and he had me hit a couple balls, and he's like, "Do you know the system already?" I was like, "Yeah." He's like, "All right, we'll throw out a rack and call out the visuals and the sweeps and everything." And I did, and he looked at me. He's like, "Why are you here?" He's like, "You know the system already." I said, "I just wanted to get it refined and make
great.
Sure I knew everything."
So where does someone interested in the video go to get it?
Stan's website at justcueit.com.
Justcueit.com?
Yeah, or just Google Stan Shuffit.
Mm-hmm.
And he has two DVDs. He has the first one, and then the so-called Centered Edge Pro 1. And then the second one, which is a two-disc set, is called the Final Chapter. That's the one that you're going to want.
The final one?
Yeah, the Final Chapter one's the one you want. If the other one would just be like memorabilia, just because he's not going to be making them for very long. Because there's no reason to make those ones anymore. It's just old information.
So the recent videos cover what the old ones do have?
Yeah. The newest one includes
everything
and more. Right.
And that they're called what?
Just the Final Chapter, discs 1 and 2. You know, it comes in a 2-disc set.
They're called the Final Chapter,
yeah.
Disc 1 and 2, even though they are all-encompassing. They include all the information.
Right.
I like what Shane just did here. Okay, Shane saying, you know what, this guy's going to run the game out on me, and I'm going to look like, you know what, if I don't,
right. See how he used the ball
rise
close
up to
the rail
occasion.
Yeah. That ball wasn't very far off the rail, so it makes it a good ball to break open the stack. If that
right.
ball were to be 2 or 3 inches off the rail, it's not a very good ball because the cue
right.
ball's not going to have a lot of speed left on it.
That's right.
Some very important information about this game that Jerry taught me a long time ago is it's common sense, but you never really think about it this way. You know, say you hit the cue ball 10 miles an hour
mm-hmm.
and you have a half ball hit on the object ball.
Mm-hmm.
Both balls are going to go 5 miles per hour until they stop.
Right.
So obviously a half ball hit is going to, you know, cut the cue ball speed in half.
That's
so
right.
That really helps
you control.
It's
hitting an object its own weight.
Right. So and that's super important. So many people, it's common sense, but I never thought about it that
right,
way.
Right, that's
you know?
That was Jerry Reisig, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I recall him saying something like that too. I went out there, I think it was 98, so that was 18 years ago. Immediately after that, I won a Camel Pro qualifier tournament. I was so psyched up, playing good.
Yeah, too bad that Camel Tour shut down. That was a really nice tour. They had a lot of added money in there once all the tobacco products left. Same with snooker. All the tobacco products left the snooker scene and payouts went down and everything. Just no sponsorship. So very thankful for all our sponsors up there. CSI, OBQs, Simonis, Pool Table Magic. Mark has been great. He's a really nice pool room here.
Phenomenal.
Old school pool room.
He's a 100
crowns.
Ball runner too, Mark.
Yeah,
you know that.
Mark is.
All right, Shane, let's see what you got, man. All right, he didn't like this, obviously. I don't know what he was trying to accomplish with it.
I think he wanted to get above the 15 there.
Well,
or he wanted to get
the
on
15,
the 6 for the side.
Know, he can shoot the 15 on the side, the 14 in the corner.
I like shooting the.
Maybe he wanted the 13. I don't know. I don't know what he had in mind, but, you know, I'm not going to even second-guess his patterns because he doesn't have patterns. Right? He's not playing patterns. There's nothing to guess.
Well, I was talking to him about patterns earlier, and one of my friends watched his 305-ball run at Steinway.
Who did it?
My friend Ron Dobzinski. Shout out to Ron.
Mm-hmm.
He helped me get ready for this tournament. The last 2 or 3 weeks, we've been playing races to 100.
Mm-hmm.
3 or 4 times a week, so I want to say thank you, Ron, for getting me in stroke. But he said he watched Shane's 305-ball run at Steinway, and he's like, I've never seen anything like it. You know, he goes two rails, inside English, you know.
Right.
Everything that the old school guys will say not to.
Right,
me,
he's a
know?
Shot-making monster.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Because I was practicing the other day, he was running wrecks, and every time I heard this stick hit a ball, it looked like a full stroke,
right.
You know, kind of like shooting the 9 at the end of a 9-ball game with authority or going 2 rails. I said, damn.
I think if they put a, you know, say a $50,000 bounty on Moscone's record, I think these guys would, you know, go into it a little bit more and figure out patterns and everything because there's a money prize. But there's no really reason to practice straight pool. Other than the fact that it improves your game, but the pros play so much rotation. There's no reason for them to.
I suddenly have a renewed interest in it because you cannot be lazy as far as your fundamentals are concerned. Every ball you miss could cost you the match.
Right.
You have to, every shot is a do or die, so you have to master your fundamentals, apply them on every shot. You have to learn the patterns, figure out how balls are going to break, how clusters are going to react to breaking them.
Absolutely.
Which ball to hit. And that helps just about every game that you play. One pocket, rotation, anything. So I'm going to start playing it a lot for the rest of the year.
I'll make a shout out to Larry Neville. He's doing pretty good after his heart surgery. He had a double bypass.
Larry Neville did?
Yes, he
oh,
did.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh?
So he He's doing much better. He actually just won a $1,000 at an 8-ball tournament out at Vibes in Sheboygan in Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
Winner break race to 7.
Congratulations.
Can't beat that.
And,
so the double bypass is pretty crazy surgery. What they do is they actually take a vein from your leg and replace the messed up arteries in your heart.
Right, that's right.
So it's a miracle that they can do that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Especially at Larry's young age, you know, he's got so much time left.
So yeah, that was surprised when he said that because he's a young guy, right?
Before the surgery, the doctor said he might never hit a ball again, so we're glad he's up on his feet.
How old is he?
Larry is 40, 41, somewhere in there.
Yeah, that's pretty...
Shout out to his wife, Ashley Neville, if they're listening. Uh-oh.
Wishing him a speedy recovery, but obviously he's already recovered if he just won a tournament, so good job.
I visited him in the hospital after the surgery, and... Oh, he was in so much pain. The doctor said most people would, you know, rather die than do the whole process again. Yeah, it's just brutal. They break your ribs and they go in. And
oh, yeah, of course. They have to do all that.
It's crazy.
Open heart surgery.
Yeah.
So. I met him once in Salisbury, Maryland at a tournament. And he was hitting some shots that are head-scratching. Some draw shots. Power shots.
Wow.
Look at that. Look what happened. And that is exactly what happens when you move the cue ball this much in a straight pool game.
I actually like him banking the one there. You know,
it was
an angle in, angle out bank.
That's all I was looking at, is that when is he going to bank
that
one?
That. So, Bob, if Bob can pull together, it's kind of hard against Shane, you know, because Shane's sitting in the chair.
Yeah,
you
Shane's
know,
got
wing,
a lot to learn about
table.
This game. I don't care how many balls he runs. Unless you figure out how to play patterns. Transition gracefully from one ball to the next, from one rack to the next.
Right, the shot before that, he just went into the stack. I don't think he really worried about where the cue ball ended up.
Right. He figured, just give me a shot and I'll shoot at it. And sometimes you don't have one.
Yeah, I wanna thank Tommy Karabatsis for teaching me that. Every single time you go into the stack, play shape for another ball. Whether it happens or not, you're still learning something.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Tom Karabatsis is a 300-ball runner himself. He's a protege at Dallas West.
Yes, I had the privilege of commentating a match with him the other day. It was a one-pocket match.
How did he play?
From up here?
No, how did how did Tom? Oh, Tom was commentating.
Yes,
oh,
Tom,
okay.
Tom and I were commentating on a one-pocket match.
So he played pretty good from up here.
From up here,
just
we both
like we
ran
are.
Out like you wouldn't believe.
We haven't missed a ball yet from up here, have
no,
we?
No, no, no. In fact, we just beat Shane from up here. Tom's got a smooth stroke. I was watching the other day.
Yeah, he does. What's he going to do with that 14 and the one ball? I like shooting the...
I like shooting the 15 right now.
I like shooting the 6 or the
15. Or the 8, 15.
I like shooting the 15, getting on the 2 and going 2 rails and hitting the 1 or the 14.
Yeah, he does have a problem over there. I forgot that. I didn't see it.
Is he going to shoot the 2 now and go into him? The 6 does pass the 15. The 15 does go in the corner as well, but you gotta get pretty decent on it. Why doesn't he shoot the 6 now? What is
he
gonna
push,
do with that?
He's gonna push
14?
The 15 down for a break shot, then use the 12 to break the 14 one. Let's see if that. Yeah, here we go. 15 is in place. Now he can break those balls.
That was a good shot.
And there's no way he can mess up. With the 2 and the 4.
Jinx him.
No, the 2 and the 4 sit in there.
Don't jinx him.
I'm not going to. I mean, okay. All right.
So now, this is what
you
I like.
You
got
to thin the 4 and shoot the 14. You have to play perfect position.
I like shooting the
or
4.
Or coming around for the 1 in the side.
Yeah, go 2 rails towards the spot.
Right.
And shoot the 1, 14. Because the 2 ball is a great key ball.
Right.
This 1 rail.
Two ball is a good key ball.
You don't want to leave the 14 as your key ball.
Key shot, no.
So, it, oh, he caught the 4 too fat.
Is he going to get there?
Nope.
Nope. Yeah. So now he's forced to play the 2.
See, that might cost him the match right there. We'll see how good he gets on the 15 from the 14. That shot right there could cost him the whole set.
Well, by the way, he's straight in.
Yeah.
Well, the only thing he can do is either draw or stop.
He'll cheat the pocket with inside. Go 2 rails towards the 1. Oh,
he did cheat it.
He cheated it, but went the other way.
Yeah.
I like getting a little closer to the 1. But here you got to make sure either he's going to stop near the rail and slow roll it or go 1 rail. I like going to 1 rail.
100%. And I would put English on it.
Just center ball here.
Yeah, I can hit it with English. Perfect. Be a little higher because my belly is going to be in the way when I bend over to shoot the 14. Bend down, shoot the 14, my belly is in the way. So I got to shoot that side.
Belly
that ball in the shot side with inside English, spin it up a little bit.
That 4 ball in the corner might cost him the set. You know, the not calling him old, but
he needs
the older
cinch
guys
that
is
one.
Pretty good.
Keep your eye on it. Don't shift your view to the cue ball.
Looks
just
like he's
keep
putting
your
top
eye
on the
14.
Cue ball.
Here we go. Oh, yeah, perfect.
That was
perfect.
Clutch right there.
Perfect.
That was a great shot. That was easy.
He placed that cue ball with his hand.
Yeah, he pulled himself out of a trap there. That's a great shot.
Okay. Well, guess what? He's got the opportunity to hand Shane Van Boning his second defeat.
Who do you
no,
lose
no,
to
no,
really?
I don't think your first one, I'm sorry, one. Yeah. Well, Bob already lost once, I think, at least.
Yeah, winning this match will get Bob into the qualifying stages,
right.
I believe. Wow. See, he's not scared anymore. You know, he's getting in stroke. You got kind of unlucky there. To get straight in on the 1, he's going to have to reach. I like playing the 1, 4 in the side. Get that 9 ball out of there. You got to get the 3 and 10 out of the way so you can break him up with the 6 or shoot the 9 and use the 11 and go into the 7-12.
I agree with the 1-4. Then you have to clear the 3-10 immediately so you can use the 6 as a break shot.
This is what I like right now. 1-4-9 and get on the 11 to bust up the 7-12.
Okay,
and then
you
use
can
the
do
10
that
as
well.
Your safety
okay.
ball.
1-4-9, you're right. You're right.
And then if he shoots the 11 and goes into the 12 is going to go off the 2 towards the side pocket anyways.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got a ton of options there.
That's right. I still prefer the 6 as a break shot, and the reason I say that...
I wouldn't touch the 6 the whole rack,
no,
trying to keep
right
it there.
No, well, the 4 is there. The 4 is the... No, I'm sorry, that's going away right now. There's plenty of opportunities to manufacture another shot. I'd like to clear the 3-10. The reason being is that if I break the balls with the 11, I don't know what's going to be next.
Or you'd go full into the 12 or split the 11. The 10 goes past the 3. I can see it from my chair right here. So if he just slow rolls this in and gets shape on the 11,
I think
that's going to win him the set because he only needs 15 balls. He needs this whole rack. He doesn't even need a break ball.
Right.
So I wouldn't even worry about if you have to move the 6, move it.
Well, he's going to have to shoot the break ball, but not to break
the
balls.
Just get straight in on it.
Right. So here he doesn't have the desired angle. He might shoot the 6, loosen up the balls if he's got an angle. He doesn't.
Uh-oh. See, here you can get stuck. You got to strike the cue ball
If he's going to shoot this ball, use a bridge.
See, I like shooting the 11 and going into the 12.
Does he have the angle?
Yeah, he's got
the angle. Because when I'm looking at the screen, I don't see much of an angle. Not one that can do damage. Okay. That angle can't inflict damage on that.
You can miss your stroke so easy on this shot.
Okay. He's not going to miss that ball. He's going to draw it and shoot the... If he's got a better angle, he'll shoot the 11 here. Otherwise, he's going to use the 10 to come around and use the 6 as a break shot. Okay. And the reason why I like that is because I'd be racking points along the way until I get to the break shot. Balls add up.
Okay. He's shooting your 6.
He's shooting the 6. He still wants that 11 as a break shot. So.
Or the 5. Get the 10 out of there.
Oh, you see what he's doing? He's using the 10 to gain the angle on the 11.
So he'll draw back a lot of balls.
You know, he definitely is knowledgeable. No doubt about it. I underestimated him earlier. But now I'm looking, and he definitely has pool intelligence.
So now let's play shape on a ball. You hit the right side of the 12. The 2 ball's going to go off the 14. Play shape
right
for the 2 in the side.
Right.
You know, this ball does not have to be hit hard.
But depending on how hard you hit them, don't you want to open up the balls?
That speed will open up the balls.
By the way, is the 12 too dead? Can you look down at the table, see if it's dead?
The 14's in the way.
Okay.
So you want to push shape on
the
14.
Yeah, he's cutting. He might go into the 12. Okay,
see,
look at that.
He hit that so hard. He wasn't playing shape for really any ball. There's Alex in the background, smiling like always.
Yeah. He's looking to see whether Shane is going to persevere. Or
Alex helped me get in the right mindset to beat Mika yesterday. I warmed up with Alex, and he keeps you loose and goofing around.
Well,
and
you
sometimes
know what?
You can't take it so serious.
Interesting you said that, because at the Derby City, he came down in the main area and
uh-oh,
shouted out, "Who wants to play some one puck?" And nobody got up.
No,
I said, "I'll play some." He said, "How are we going to play?" I said, "We'll play even. We played 20 a game. We played for 4 hours. We played a total of 9 games. I won 2. He was the greatest guy to hang out with and learn from, and I got so inspired playing
him. He'll tell
him
you what shot to shoot against.
I almost won the mini tournament the next day. I came 3rd in it. You know, I was 1 ball away from being in the finals.
Everybody else listening, if you want to play Efren or Bustamante or Jeffrey Ignacio, anybody, go to the Derby City Classic. All the Filipinos get up early. They're at the pool room at 9 o'clock. You can play $20 sets with all the Filipinos
right
every single morning all week long. I played Ignacio some 15-ball rotation, and I learned so much just by, you know,
right,
the way he plays. I mean, can't say enough about how good Jeffrey plays.
And that was so inspiring for me playing Alex for all this time. I mean, it's like getting up and playing baseball with Babe Ruth.
Right.
And people, no one wanted to get up and play. Well,
right.
What are you scared of?
I mean, Efren, unless he's really tired, Efren's not going to say no, you know. Just play, you know.
Look at that 12 ball. Look at that 12 ball. He made a break shot out of that. He made a break shot out of the 8.
No reason for a break shot. He's going to run these
balls. Oh, yeah, you're right. yeah. But listen, if he wants to keep running balls, because he's on a streak right here, man. You know,
I don't
he might want to keep running balls.
No, he's not worried
to
about
just
running balls.
Stick the fork further, you know. Stick that fork a little deeper.
Don't let Shane hear you.
No, I know. Listen, he's a world champion. No matter what you say, he's not going to give a damn about what I'm saying.
Right.
I'm just.
This is a shot of the match right here.
Oh my God. Bob.
He's scrambling.
What does he need?
Two balls?
2 balls, right?
Bob's scrambling. See here. Draw this ball 1 rail and get on the 8. Put a good stroke on this ball. Oh, don't get too close to the rail.
He's perfect. Shoot it. Hey, someone needs to tell Bob Jewett not to attempt to break the ball, dude. Because he's got a straight-in break shot. Good shooting. Listen, I'm impressed with what he's done. Seriously. Earlier in the match, he had a couple of questionable plays. And after that, he showed that he knows how to play patterns his own way. He transitioned from one ball to another, hit and stop kind of things, and he got the right angle to finally bust the balls open, you know. So I am very impressed. Good job. Good job, Bob. Excellent match. Bob Jewett over Shane Van Boning, 125 to 81. Sorry, guys, you bet on the wrong horse.